Welcome to this presentation. I am Jan Treur, the second author, and I will give some presentation about our ideas about a project that we are now, say, halfway in. This project can be described by a number of steps. You already have a lot of literature from neuroscience about how humans function, what mechanisms are underlying behavior and mental processes. This can be a good source to do some modeling, that you have computer models, in this case causal AI models that we use for the simulation of such processes. And then you can make a form that you can call artificial agents or artificial humans that are, in contrast to natural humans, built in a computational manner. And the step from the simulation by itself to that form of artificial humans, you can call that virtualizing. You make some avatars that express the things that are computed in the simulation. But then the interesting thing occurs, that you can make sessions with these artificial humans and the natural humans. And in these sessions, a lot of things can be learned from each other. I will make that clear during this presentation. So let's look at part one about the modeling side. Causal modeling is done from a dynamical system perspective. By itself, causal modeling is a transparent and declarative type of modeling approach, which has a long tradition in AI. But in this tradition, there are also some limitations, that the dynamics of causation, how fast some certain causes have their effects, for example, but also the adaptivity of the causal relations themselves, what often happens during, for example, learning, is not addressed well. So that is a real limitation, but we have recently developed some solutions for that by using a network science perspective, and then add dynamics and adaptivity to the causal modeling area. I will discuss that in brief now. So then we can have any dynamical system modeled in a causal, from a causal perspective, in a causal flavor, say. So the idea is that you define networks where you have connections between states, like mental states, for example, that influence each other. And they can have weights. And you can also have aggregation of different impacts from different sides. If you have different connections to one state that come together there. And you can have timing, that you can specify how fast the response of a state is on the causal impact, so how fast the causal effect really occurs. So these are just the basic concepts between our types of network models. And you can use them for different forms of dynamics. You can have, for example, dynamics in social processes, like you see in emotion contagion, or information diffusion, or opinion spread. But you can also use them to model mental processes, like an interplay of certain mental states, like how beliefs influence your intentions and many other things, and also emotions, for example. So that these networks give a really wide applicability. So that's the dynamics within networks you can consider, but you can also consider dynamics of networks. And that means that the network structure characteristics, as I just mentioned them, the connection weights, for example, but also other ones, that they can also change over time. So then we have these three types of characteristics: the connectivity characteristics, aggregation characteristics, and timing characteristics. And all of them can have some form of adaptation, or some of them just your own choice. So these are, for example, chasing the connection weights, which is a rather familiar subject to many machine learning approaches. They use neural networks and where the connection weights are changed. But you can also have aggregation adaptation when you change combination functions, and for example, you change excitability thresholds of your activation of your nodes of the network. And you can also have change of the speed factors so that the timing is also adaptive. I will tell a bit more about realistic principles for those types of adaptations in a moment. But first I show the idea of self-modeling that we have used to get this adaptation done in a network. So that the idea is that it's like in a picture, you have this thing, you can see it as a self-model of this situation. Or this picture can be seen as a self-model of the real situation in that picture. So that's an idea that has been applied to get the idea of self-modeling networks. So this is a kind of picture-in-picture metaphor used for networks. And that's then the base picture. You have the self-model of the picture. And it's not a very good example. This is also not a very good example because you don't even see where it is self-modeled of. But that's just the general idea, that you have things that model the whole thing or parts of the whole thing in itself. So this is another example, a bit more clear. Now you have this picture in the picture, but now you have two things in the picture, then you can also continue this whole thing, and then you have a kind of infinite regress. That's also an issue in the network self-modeling, because you always need to accept that it is partial. You don't have a self-model of the whole network, because as soon as you add a self-model, that network is already different, and then you have to repeat it again. So then you get these things. But if you accept that it's not complete description in the self-model, then it's feasible. So this is another example. Let me see. This is a famous Dutch brand of chocolate and cocoa. And that's already since 1904 that they use this picture type, these spikes types of pictures. So this is another example where you see this infinite regress. But let me continue to the network modeling. How can a network model itself? You add a cell model to it. That's a subnetwork with states representing the network structure characteristics. So you have states representing characteristics. That's the main idea here. And you can have different possibilities. You can have, say, characteristics for the connectivity characteristics for the aggregation or for the timing. And for example, this connection weight or this parameter for the excitability threshold or the speed factor, these are characteristics. And you add states for them as a kind of small copy of the picture. And you add it to the network model. So these are then the self-model states. And in fact, this is what you generally have to do. If you do some adaptive modeling, you always have to change or to assign variables to the parameters so that they can also change. And that's exactly what happens here. But in this case, these variables have just already a meaning in the sense of the network, in the sense that they are just nodes in the network. So that's a special type of concept. So that gives a uniform and declarative manner to model adaptive networks. So it's very useful and easy to use also. And also you can do it in multiple orders, even that the adaptation itself can also be adaptive. You don't need to do procedural specifications nor programming. What often happens is people do adaptivity. Usually they just enter the programming level instead of having a declarative type of modeling. And now you can cover adaptive dynamics, which otherwise would not be in the network-oriented modeling area or in the causal modeling area. So some principles are described in the literature on cognitive neuroscience. For example, this is called plasticity. The synapses within neurons can change. are also intrinsic properties of neuroscan chains. And there is a lot of focus in general on these connections, but also these intrinsic neuronal properties, they have also some attention recently. You also have other types of adaptation principles like this. Adaptation accelerates with stimulus exposure. That means that this is adaptation of adaptation, the acceleration of the adaptation. So that is a process that you call metaplasticity in the literature. Another one is high stress levels show down or block adaptation from Kasia, for example. So these are different levels, different orders of adaptation. So this is first order, you can say, but this is second order. So the Hebbian learning principle for connection weights, the simple version of this is like neurons that fire together, wire together. So if you use some connection, the neurons, they are activated, then the connection will become stronger. It's a very familiar type of principle. But you also have these types of principles in different variants for the intrinsic excitability, for example, for internal structures within the neurons themselves. So let's see how we can illustrate this by an emotion regulation example. For example, suppose we have a simple model like this. There is a stressful stimulus that is sensed by the person, like stressful events around the person. There is some image in the brain, a sensory representation of this stressful situation, and that triggers some emotional response. It's of a stressful emotion, and that also leads to some emotional feeling state for it, with some cyclic process in general. But there is also a way to control your emotions or your stressful emotions by emotion regulation, which is a very important field in psychology, especially recent years have shown that it plays a role in many disorders if you don't do the emotion regulation well. So this control is a very important factor in your mental health. So this, if this emotion, the stressful emotion is too strong, then you have some effect on activation of that control state, which is normally in the prefrontal cortex in the brain, situated as is thought. But this, and then it can have some effect, for example, to suppress this stressful emotion. But you can also, if it's not so working well, then you can have a therapy for it that influences this control state and it can help your learning, because learning is a very important issue here. Stress itself already blocks learning, but if you can activate the learning again, then you have a chance to get out of the situation, and therapy can help for that. This is the learning itself that has a self-model state for the learning. So this W that represents this strength of this connection for the monitoring, say, from the feeling state by the control state. And then it can affect the control state because of the connection is becoming stronger by learning. So that's the self-model at the first order. And we also have the second order. Remember the principle that a stimulus or stressful emotion can block the learning. So that's represented by this. And it's also a similar thing for the persistence. So that they are influenced also by these levels there. And then they have their influence on the speed and on the persistence of what you are learning. So this is a relatively simple example, a bit simplified, of course, to keep it a bit limited in size as an illustration. And this gives the idea of a self-model for stress blocks adaptation and also for persistence modulation. It gives a first order self model for the learning. So let's show some of the simulations of this model. So this is the stimulus. There is the feeling, stressful feeling about because of the stimulus. And then this is the control state for the regulation of it. And you see that it is poor regulation. It's not high. These are the activation levels. So then, therefore, there is in this period no change, no real improvement. But then there is a therapy state coming in. And that's this one. And then you see immediately the effect on the control state, and therefore also the downward effect on the feeling state. So how does that work on the self-modeling levels? Well, you see that initial there is no learning because the learning is blocked. The speed of learning is practically zero here. And now because of the therapy, the speed goes up. And the control state goes up, but also the speed goes up then because the suppression of the feeling state, the stressful state. Then you have a kind of acceleration of the learning, and this acceleration stays a bit higher also after the therapy finishes. And then after the therapy, the person has the learning boost is really helping to address the situation by the person itself, himself or herself. So then there is no need anymore for the therapy. So even in such a relatively small example, you can already give some illustration of how a therapy can have its positive effect. So that's the persistence side. So the next step, remember, that is the virtualization. After you have such simulations, you want to express them, to display them, so that humans can really have interaction with them. That's the idea in general here. So then we can use avatars, like this is an example of an avatar that can show different types of emotions. There are many types of avatars available at the moment. And then you can see that, for example, this feeling level, this negative feeling level, you can express that in the faces over the time. And then this is just a sketch of it, but normally you would make it in a continuous sense. And then if now it comes lower, the stress level, you can see the face also comes higher. And then here you get into some kind of neutral situation. This is how the idea of the project that we do works. You make the modeling, and then you relate the modeling to an expression by an avatar that can have a real interaction with humans. So this is a small example for that you can find on internet of a small movie. Let me just jump in it after a while. So then they use some form of thermostat for the amount of empathy. They apply it in the context of autism spectrum situations. So this gives some reflection of what actually goes on in the brain, and they show it in this type of presented pictures or movies, how that can be used to explain what happens here. There is some imitation-like or joint action-like things. And the girl also copies that behavior. And then it's related to high level of empathy. And this is for another situation. And then this boy does not copy the situation. So then it is related to a low empathy. So that's a bit of an idea of how this can work. I will just skip it to save some time. Yeah. So we have already seen this. Let me see. The different stages we have discussed. Now this is already familiar. I didn't discuss that, but there is a lot of literature. We make models out of it, and these models can be simulated, and then by virtualizing them, you can get these artificial humans, and then this movie already gives some idea of how You can watch such virtual situations, or you can even interact with them to learn things. And this learning, I just want to say a bit of background for that. It has some similarity to Paulo Freire's pedagogical literacy method. He teaches teachers to collect problematic situations from the learners' contexts and visualize by pictures. Then they have sessions as a form of education to discuss these pictures and develop language to talk about them. And these pictures, they should empathically feel for them as recognizable. So what we do is actually a bit similar like that. We want to present such situations that may show certain mental problems, and persons in a kind of therapy or a coaching session can relate to such situations and then recognize and get more insight in their own situation. So this is what is called the Cozy Human, I should say, project. It is for cooperative simulated human. This is to explore such possibilities for mental processes and therapies for them, and to develop tools to support these processes. To keep the time a bit limited, I will just skip in the paper. There is already a paper available if you want. You can see different steps for it. And finally, what we are in the stage now, we already did a lot of the modeling part. We have good tools for that. We are now in the phase to develop things for the virtualization, to have a virtualization dashboard to connect the different types of software, the software for the modeling and the software for the expressing of the avatars, and also for the interaction session. So if you want to see some further references, this is some overview of a number of possibilities. Thanks for your attention.